This is a New Hampshire Outlook special presentation. Author, father, husband, reporter, cancer survivor. Dana Jennings is all that. He is best known for his series of blogs in the New York Times about his ongoing fight against prostate cancer. His blogs are honest and raw, sad and hilarious, and they have helped thousands of his readers through their own ordeals.
I'm 52 years old, and I've written half a dozen books and edited and written, you know, millions and millions of magazine and newspaper words. But doing the blog is it's the most meaningful work I've done in my career.
We caught up with Jennings during a week-long visit to UNH journalism classes, where he shared some professional advice on getting hired.
The woman who interviewed me from Human Resources said, you know, you used to work at the Journal, you don't want to do sports, do you? And I said, of course I do. Whenever anyone asks you, you know, do you want to do this, you say yes.
Transforming his life experience into useful advice for others has been a surprising development for this self-described country boy from Kingston, New Hampshire.
Sometimes people wonder whether I'm from the South because, you know, literally, you know, my dad raced stock cars. You know, we grew up listening to Hank Williams and Johnny Cash and Kitty Wells. And we'd sit out on the porch and Dad and my other relatives would tell stories. And, you know, we'd play music on the record player. And it was, you know, a lot of times it'd be country music.
Well, you said you grew up in essentially sort of a tar paper kind of home, no indoor plumbing.
Right. The very first house we lived in was, and even the houses after, it was pretty raw living. My folks were only 17 when they got married. I was born 8 days later, which makes it really easy to remember their anniversary. And the first house we lived in was, I suppose you could call it a duplex, but it had once been a shoe shop. It was a shoe factory. It had just been divvied in half. And there was cold running water, but that was it. I mean, we had an outhouse.
So there you were out in the country. Did you ever think that you might end up at the New York Times?
Oh, God. I mean, even when I was in college, you know, in the fall of 75 when I was a freshman here, if someone had said, you know, you're going to end up being an editor and writer at the New York Times, I would have said, you know, no way. You know, I thought maybe if I paid my dues, you know, maybe I might end up at the Boston Globe. I was ambitious. I knew I wanted to leave Kingston, but I wasn't that classic kid who was, you know, dying to leave his hometown to go to New York City. I mean, and to be honest, I mean, New York City seemed impossible. It was a mythical place and really scary.
Jennings studied journalism at UNH under the late Donald Murray. He graduated in 1980 and returned 30 years later as the Donald Murray visiting journalist.
I never expected to be a cancer blogger. In fact, there's no question that my incredulous wife and two sons would have voted me least likely to blog. I'm one of those mulish late adopters, the kind of guy who wouldn't mind living half a mile down some pocked and rutted logging road. I like the static on my car radio as I groove to the oldies station. But then a few things happened that launched me into the blogosphere. First, in the summer of 2008, I found out that my cancer was much more aggressive than expected. My doctors had me pegged for a pokey little stage one prostate cancer. Not great, but not so bad either, if you have to have cancer. But the post-surgical pathology report revealed that I had a fast-moving, cell-guzzling stage 3 cancer. I went from thinking of my cancer as just some wicked frost heave on the Route 125 of my life to wondering whether I'd be at my son's weddings, see my grandchildren. Luckily, the Red Sox had finally won a World Series. I was trying to work on a book proposal and take a reasonable stab at holding down my editing job at the New York Times. But I was obsessing so hard over having cancer that I couldn't write, could barely think. I started chewing over one of my favorite pieces of writing advice from Don Murray. When something is blocking a piece of writing, write about what's blocking it. In less than 3 weeks, my first post about coping with prostate cancer appeared on the New York Times Well blog.
In your first blog, when you, I think in November of 08, you noted that many friends tried to comfort you at that time, saying, well, at least you have a good cancer. At the time, did you buy that?
No, you know, part of it is, you know, when you first find out you have any serious illness, you get rubbed pretty raw, and you're trying to figure out what this is going to mean to your life. And I appreciated the fact that these people were trying to be kind to me, but the idea of calling any cancer a good cancer just it just ticked me off. I mean, there's just no such thing as a good cancer. And you know, you can tell your friend or your relative that, you know, you're really sorry, you know, this just totally stinks, but you can't say to someone that you have a good cancer.
You know, and there's different kinds of cancer too, obviously lung cancer, I mean, you name it. Is prostate cancer easier or more difficult, do you think, to write about?
Well, you know, one of the things about prostate cancer is that, you know, all of the treatment options hit men where they live. And even if you don't have surgery, often incontinence and impotence are the byproduct of the treatment. And I think men are getting better about talking about it, but men don't have the openness that women have about telling tales to each other. And to get back to your earlier question, I wasn't finding writing about prostate cancer that I wanted to read. I wanted the Nora Ephron of prostate cancer. You know, I wanted someone who was funny and honest and blunt. And when I realized that, you know, I guess I have to write about this.
One of the things I think really touched many people was your writing about your relationship with your wife.
Mm-hmm.
And how hard was it to reveal so much, and how did she feel about it?
Well, we agreed before I even wrote the first post that, you know, anything I wrote about that specifically touched on her life, I would bounce off of her. And, you know, I think that the way that I've written about private matters in the blog,
that's pretty frank.
Yeah, but, you know, I try to be delicate and respectful. And to be honest, it's just another example of how indispensable she is in my life. I've said this a number of times, but I feel really blessed by the woman that I married. We've been married since 1981, and you know, just she gives me so much to live up to if the time ever comes where the roles are reversed. I mean, and you would never choose to have cancer, but having it has just impossibly deepened our relationship. I mean, it's better than ever. One real frustration is I really feel like, you know, whether it's intentional or not, that doctors really play down the issues of incontinence and impotence when it comes to prostate cancer treatment. I think possibly they're afraid that men will elect not to have surgery or to have certain kinds of treatment, but it...
Well, you addressed that in a very recent column, didn't you? I think the True Manhood column.
Yeah.
Well, was that, even though you've been frank throughout this, was that sort of breaking some new ground for you?
You know, one of the lingering after effects for me has been erectile dysfunction. You know, and men really don't want to talk about that.
We don't even like the ads for it.
Right, the ads, you know, forget about the ads, you know. And who has those tubs in the front yard? That's what I want to know. And I know now I'm going to, you know, sound like a hopeless middle-aged white man, but, you know, our culture is so sexualized, and, you know, it's a, people can't articulate anymore the difference between sex and intimacy and love. And I just wanted, you know, I really felt the need to write about that, you know, even though I was having, you know, physically I was having sexual problems, that's really not what defines, you know, real manhood.
A lot of phrases that strike me that you sort of come up with these columns, like cancer standard time, which really encapsulate a theme and an experience, don't they?
Yeah, the one of the great things about having been able to blog and then also eventually be a regular writer for the Science Times section is that I've been able to explore kind of more theoretical ideas about being sick. And it fascinated me how time becomes so strange when you're seriously ill and you're being treated. And, you know, it's not a traditional take on cancer, but there is that sense that time just becomes Twilight Zone-like. I just thought it was important to articulate that to readers who, you know, really felt off balance or off kilter because they're going through this experience.
I want to ask you about your buzz cut column.
I'm letting it grow up now.
It's noticed, yeah, it's really long right now. You said you needed the primal ferocity that a buzz cut proclaims.
Okay. In a time of utter vulnerability, having already weathered 3 months of post-diagnosis ups and downs, I needed the primal ferocity that a buzz cut proclaims. I needed to look like a soccer thug or an extra from Prison Break to help get me through surgery, the physical indignities of post-op life, and my subsequent radiation and hormone therapy. I still do.
You also wrote in that same column that you couldn't bear at that time to look at earlier photographs of yourself.
Yeah.
So it was as if you were assuming a new look, a new style, a new identity for what you were going through.
Right. This was my cancer identity. The jacket photo in that book, I would look at that photo and I would just say, you know, who is that guy? You know, he just seems too happy, kind of ignorant. And, you know, my hair, when I let it grow out, is kind of that classic floppy Glen Campbell kind of hair.
You wrote one called When a Family Gets Cancer, really exploring the fact that everybody is affected. And that works all its way down to your dog, Bijou, who becomes such an important character. Bijou de Minuit. And you wrote that at one point it was her health that you were most worried about, even though you were not doing well at the time. Mm-hmm. How much of a role did Bijou and her own miseries play in your recovery?
Well, it's funny, when in the summer of 2008, when I had my my surgery to remove my prostate, she was in good health, and it was fascinating to me to watch her respond to me. You know, I wasn't sleeping in my usual bed, and you know, I'm not going to, you know, make it as if she was, you know, she understood perfectly that, you know, that Daddy wasn't doing well. But it gave me such solace when she would jump up on the bed and curl up at my feet, or she would, you know, come over to the side of the bed and ask me to scratch her ears. And the one thing she did, which when I first got home from the hospital, it would make me so happy. Her water bowl was in the hall. And just something about listening to her lapping up her water just was so soothing. There was just something sweet and natural about it. And the sound really meant a lot to me. I began to realize that our dogs and their carefree dogginess make us more human, force us to shed our narcissistic skins. Even when you have cancer, you can't be utterly self-involved when you have a floppy-eared mutt who needs to be fed, walked, and belly scratched. And you can't help but ponder the mysteries of creation as you gaze into the eyes of your dog, or wonder why and how we chose dogs and they chose us. Dogs also tell us, especially when we're sick, of our own finitude. And partly that's why we cry when they die, because we also know that all human being stories in the same way too.
Maybe the biggest response you got to a column, I think, might have been for the column you called
My Brief Life as a Woman. As my wife and I sat on the couch one night this past winter, reading and half watching the inevitable HGTV, I started sweating hard, and my face got so fevered and flushed that I felt as if I were peering into an oven. I turned to Deb and said, "Man, I'm having a wicked hot flash." And she said, "Me too." Then we laughed. You laugh a lot, unless your hormones are making you cry, when you're having menopause with your wife. I was in the middle of treatment for an aggressive case of prostate cancer last winter, and it included a 6-month course of hormone therapy. My Lupron shots suppressed testosterone, which is the fuel for prostate cancer. When your testosterone is being throttled, there are bound to be side effects. So, with the help of Lupron, I spent a few months aboard the good ship Menopause, with all the physical baggage that entails. It's a trip that most men don't expect to take. When I wasn't devouring a king-size Italian sub or smoldering from a hot flash, it seemed that I was crying. There are other side effects too, like headaches and fatigue. But when I started drinking Diet Coke for the first time in my life, my son Owen couldn't take it anymore. He said, "Dad, are you turning into a chick?"
Another sort of area you explored is some of the contradictions in medicine, where mm-hmm. you have to take poison in order for the poison to help. Mm-hmm. And I like the way that you explored that.
My surgery was a radical open prostatectomy because I wasn't a good candidate for the procedure they call robotic surgery. And, you know, it was major surgery. I mean, it was, 25 staples up the middle of my gut. Hormone therapy just totally screws up your chemistry. I mean, I still have a lingering after effect from the hormone therapy of still getting very tired. My chemistry is just messed up. And of course, you know, radiation, I mean, that's, you know, besides killing cancer cells, radiation is also killing healthy cells. It's as if, you know, you're accepting these weapons of attacking the cancer within your body, and you're the battlefield, and we all know what happens to battlefields. They don't stay pristine. I have this persona of being a redneck Jew. I'm the guy at my synagogue where, you know, if people want to talk about country music, stock car racing, you know, squirrel hunting, you know, it's like, well, let's ask Dana.
In your talk a little earlier this week, you were talking about your conversion to Judaism. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, what can you tell us about that?
It's funny. My wife is Jewish, and, you know, both my sons were bar mitzvahed, and, you know, I found that to be a really powerful thing for me, even though at that time I wasn't Jewish. And I realized in the early 2000s that, Judaism had become really important to me, and I decided to convert. And, you know, one of the really valuable things when I got sick is that Judaism really, it was one of the ways that I could look at my cancer. And it let me ask a really crucial question, you know, which is also a journalistic question, but it's like, what can this cancer teach me? you know, trying to think of it as, you know, as an occasion for learning about yourself, made it a little more acceptable.
So often we read things like, Mr. Smith died yesterday after a long, courageous battle with cancer. And you call that one of the cliches of cancer. I bet there's a lot more.
Yeah, we love that for whatever reason when it comes to serious disease, and I guess it's because we're struggling to try to articulate what's happening to somebody. We use that war imagery, and
I mean, you never hear or read a short, pointless fight with.
Right. The poor guy died of cancer, so I really dislike that idea of fighting. And one of the best realizations I had in thinking about it is, we're the battlefield. So when you're the battlefield, you're not fighting. It's the cancer here, and it's the doctors and their tools there, and they're engaging each other in your body.
So you're what's being fought over.
Yeah, I mean, you're not fighting. You're where the action is happening. And that brings me to the word courageous. I believe in having a good attitude, but I also believe in, if you feel like hell on a given day, you can just pout and turn away from, whoever wants to talk to you. But I don't feel like it's courageous, because I think you understand it's your life, we're trained to do what we can to preserve our lives. I'm leading a post-cancer life right now. I couldn't be up here in Durham, New Hampshire this week speaking to college classes if I didn't feel that I was in a post-cancer moment. That doesn't mean that I'm unrealistic. There's always the statistics about recurrence rates and stuff, but I'm with Charlie Brown in the famous Charlie Brown strip where someone is reciting how bad Charlie Brown's baseball team is, and Charlie Brown says, "Tell your statistics to shut up." And that's the way I feel about statistics. Statistics are valuable, but they're general, and I'm me, and I'm not a statistic.
What's next for Dana Jennings?
I'm actually in the process of writing a proposal that will collect the cancer columns. So I'm hoping that a publisher will want to do that. It's always tricky collecting work that's already been published. But I'll be the title of the book is going to be My Brief Life as a Woman. One man's dispatches from the front lines of prostate cancer.
Dan Jennings, thank you so much for speaking.
Thank you very much,
this.
Richard. Thanks. And here's my post from today's Well blog. Here's what I'm thinking right now. After cancer, everyday miracles. It's been 2 years since I learned that I had prostate cancer, and a bit more than a year since I completed treatment for what I eventually learned was an aggressive stage 3 cancer. Being from the sticks of New Hampshire, I'm reminded of a woods after a fire. There's still plenty of scorched earth and charred deadfalls, but more important, the green scrub and optimistic wildflowers are creeping back. I'm in pretty good shape these days. I live from PSA test to PSA test every 3 months. And so far, so good. I still get more tired than I would like because my body chemistry is still in ferment from hormone therapy. And to get an erection, I have to inject my penis with Caver Eject, which stimulates blood flow. It's not as bad as it sounds, honest. But those are just physical details. I'm more interested in what I've learned from my cancer, how it has actually and unexpectedly changed me. Cancer is a hard teacher, but a teacher even so. More than ever, I know that I'm blessed in sons and my marriage. That on a cold winter's night, a pint of porter in the company of a good neighbor is a bounty in this uncertain world. Post-cancer, I love who and what I love more deeply than ever, and I keenly feel in my bones the sheer evanescence of our existence.